Thank you so much. You may be seated. Well, on behalf of the Foran family, I thank you for coming today to help us to celebrate the life of Richard Joseph Foran. And so today, as I've already shared with the family, these are always difficult times of loss, no matter at what stage of life we lose one of our loved ones. It's a challenge. And so whatever your connection with the family today, whether you're friends or perhaps even extended family, I just encourage you to embrace this moment, to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us, to give us the strength, certainly to grieve and allow all of our emotions to do their good work in our heart today as we do our best to celebrate this wonderful man. With that in mind, I'd like to just open us up in a short word of prayer. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you this day. We thank you knowing that you are here with us, that you are choosing to be in this place, because as much as we have come here today to honor Richard's life, we also honor you knowing that you are such a part of his life. So Holy Spirit, we pray that you would minister specifically to the family today, bring them comfort, bring them encouragement, bring them strength of spirit, bring them peace this day. And help us to honor this man. In your name we pray, amen. Before Pastor Justin and the worship team lead us in a few worship songs, just want to begin by reading a well-known portion of scripture for us, that being the 23rd Psalm. It says this: "The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessing. Surely goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever." Let's stand and sing these songs together in the name of the Lord.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, and whatever my lot, and thou hast taught me to say, it is well, and it is well with my soul, and it is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul,
and it is well, and it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight, and the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, and the trump shall resound, and the
Seated.
Praise the Lord. Well, for those of us that have not yet met, my name is Chris, and I'm one of the pastors here at Rock Church. And on behalf of our entire church family, we extend our deepest condolences to Dennis and Karen and Stephen and the entire Foran family. We were blessed to have Richard a part of our church family for the last little while, and we will treasure that as a part of our experience here as a church family, certainly. So at this time, I'm going to invite those that are coming to give family tributes to come now.
I've come prepared. Might not be enough. Thanks, everyone, for being here. The very first sermon I gave on a Sunday morning, I cried, and I realized very quickly that I couldn't speak and cry at the same time. So I had to compose myself for about 5 minutes while I'm just my back turned to everyone, and the older ladies in the congregation were saying, "It's okay, honey, we've all been there." I'm like, okay. For me at least, I guess I should give some context. I'm Joey, Joseph Millington, Karen's son, grandson to Richard. And for me at least, it's not as much about getting the opportunity to say goodbye. I told you. As it is getting to say hello so many times. Some of my first memories of my grandfather was, I think I was 3, and we're driving down this dirt road into this wooded area with this wooden house. And he's at the end, you know, greeting us. And that's the first memory I have. And it's a happy memory because in that house, we have so many. It's long, so it's going to be a while. And I don't want to cut anything. No, I said, don't come up, I'm crying. All right, here we go. It's a great place because I have so many good memories being in that house. And near the end, I'll explain that. Because he moved into this house in Windsor, outside of Windsor, probably, 2-3 years after the passing of Grammy. And he just loved being alone. And I got that impression a little bit throughout the 30 years that I've gotten to know him. Even though he lived roughly 50 minutes away from Halifax, from where I grew up, he would frequently make the trip to Timberley and later Hammond's Plains for important dinners, birthdays, holidays, and random moments. And you would know Grampy arrived because of the beeping noise his truck or later his little Jeep would make when he backed up into a parking spot, which I thought was normal, but no, they're not. Jeeps aren't supposed to make that noise. He obviously custom did his Jeep up to make sure everybody knew when he was arriving and when he was leaving. Even when Grampy was back in Windsor, he would make sure to call every day to check in on Mom and the family, literally every single day. Most of these conversations were very short, you know, within a minute or two sometimes, but more reliable than the 6 o'clock news. He had an uncanny ability to phone the moment everyone sat down for dinner. It didn't matter if we ate at 5 or 6 or 7, the moment the last person sat down, the phone would ring. My dad would say, "Who's that phoning at this time of night?" Mom would answer the phone. We would hear in that little speakerphone, "Howdy." And then Mom would say, "Hi, Dad." And then we'd be like, "Oh, of course, it's Grampy. He always phones when we're having dinner." Grampy was notoriously early to everything, like early. Not just 15 minutes early, but sometimes hours early to everything. My wife and I, Lauren, who's not here today because they're back in New Zealand, funny story coming, all right? Just give me a second. We worked in the valley at a church called New Hope Wesleyan Church, And from 2015 to 2016, and Grampy would attend on Sunday mornings, you know, once every 6 to 8 weeks, which is really good, because he went to a church in Windsor, then he would come into the city sometimes and go to church with Mom. He was went around a lot. And we had two services, a 9:30 and an 11 a.m., and around 9:29, I would hear that Jeep backing up into a parking spot. The car park is empty. It's a dirt car park, parking lot, and he would just have to back up somewhere for some reason. And I'd walk out because I see him out of the window, and I'd be like, oh, he's just in time for church. So I walk down, go outside in the winter, and I say, Grampy, you come on in. Church is about to start. He's like, no. I'm here for the 11. I'm like, so he has his coffee in his hand, listening to the radio, just sitting there for about an hour, and then he comes in about 10:30 and starts to talk to people. He really liked his alone time. While still living in the valley, I got a frantic call from Mom after church one Sunday around 12 o'clock saying that she hadn't heard from Grampy all morning, which was very, very alarming. She phoned a few times with no answer, and she said I needed to head to his place to see if he's okay. And I'm thinking the worst, right? He's probably, what, 82, 81 at the time? And I'm like, oh, no, I've got to go to his place. He's probably fallen over maybe for the first time ever. Or, heaven forbid, something worse. So, and I had never been to his place in 15 years because he got so much stuff, he just went to us instead of us going to him at some point in time. So I'm on my way with Lauren in the passenger seat. We're quiet. We're like, okay, this is not going to be good. Hopefully it's good, but it doesn't sound like it's going to be. So we take the exit to Windsor, about to go down the road towards Chester, or wherever that road is, to his place. And I get a phone call from Mom saying, everything's fine. I said, okay, what happened? Well, I phoned the police, and they showed up at his place, and then he just drove up, and he's like, what are you doing here? And then the police say to him, sir, you're not okay. It's like, no, I'm okay. Well, your daughter was very worried about you. He's like, I just forgot my phone at home. That's the only thing. And if I could boil down my mom and his relationship, it'd probably be that kind of scenario where she worries immensely about him, and he always says, I'm just fine, leave me alone sometimes. Grampy was always a meat and potatoes kind of guy, and that's not a euphemism. He really, if it was left to him, he would only eat meat and potatoes. He was probably the pickiest eater I've ever met, even to this day. In his place in Windsor, in his little wooden shack, he had a massive freezer, and it was filled with frozen pizzas, about this big, and circle ones. And they were cheese pizzas. He doesn't like cheese. So you pick the cheese off and just have dough with sauce on it. And honestly, I'm very surprised and shocked he made it to 87 over the past 30 years because his diet was so bad. Lauren and I took him to this crepe place once in Wolfville when we were living there, and that was probably one of the biggest mistakes I've made in my relationship with a grandfather. You may have been there before. It's in Wolfville on Main Street. And we took him there, and we said, Grampy, it's a great place. They have donair crepes, burger, cheeseburger crepes, you know, crepes, whatever you want. It's in a crepe. It's really awesome. And he's like, oh, okay. And he saw breakfast, and he's like to the waiter, I'd like the bacon, the eggs, the sausage, and toast. And the waiter says, sorry, sir, we only do crepes. And he looks worried at us and then looks back at the waiter. He says, okay, I'll just have sausage, egg, and bacon. And then the person leaves, we order, and then the food comes, and it's then served into a crepe. And he looks at us like, what have you done to my breakfast? He did not enjoy that meal, and we never took him there again. We took him to the pub next door for fish and chips after that. The only time I can think of when my grandpa was the other time, a lot of food-related stories, I'm sorry. Sorry, Grampy. There was one time about 6 years ago where we had a big family gathering, and Mom had bought cheesecake to eat. And she said, don't tell Grampy that it's cheesecake. Just tell him it's something else, because I'm going to see if he likes it. And we're like, okay. So she serves up the cheesecake at the end of the meal, and Grampy looks at it suspiciously. And he's like, is this cheesecake? And Mom's like, no, it's not cheesecake. You're going to love it. I'm like, okay. And then he loves it. He eats it, scoffs it down. And then mom, you know, in a daughter kind of relationship to a father, says, "Ha, I knew you'd love it. You love cheese." And he just looks at her with like utter betrayal and said, almost like, "My daughter, my own flesh and blood, how could you do this to me? I liked it, but not enough to try it." See, I have so many Grampy stories because, and a lot of them are funny, because he's just like a situationally funny guy, at least in my life. I have so many stories because he was always present. He was always there. He was just always around. He would show up for, you know, birthdays, dinners, always Easter, always Christmas, and always those random meals. And I had a great opportunity when I was 11 years old to travel to Windsor, Ontario with him in his Jeep, and I was not the best co-pilot. I was 11. What am I going to say to my grandfather when I'm 11 and he's, what, like in his early 70s at the time? I just slept the entire way there, which I don't think he enjoyed very much. But it was a really great chance to kind of just get into his world that, you know, now looking back, I really appreciate. And he's always been a man of very few words, at least in my lifetime. I don't know what it was like growing up with him when, you know, he was younger, but he would always have these wonderful one-syllable words. And I remember I was in New Zealand in 2020. It was some point in the pandemic, and Mom said, "Oh, you should talk to your grandfather on the phone." I said, "Okay," and I'm thinking it's not going to be a long conversation because he's a man of really short words, but I didn't know it was going to be this short. I said, "Grampy, how are things going?" He said, "Good." I said, "Anything new happening?" He said, "Nope." I said, "Oh, great. Great talking to you." He's like, "Okay." I'm like, "All right. Hope you have a good day." And it wasn't like, because the relationship's great. He's just really quick, really short words. And Grampy was always a man around me, and so quiet, he didn't talk much about his faith in Jesus, but you just saw it everywhere, but he didn't talk about it that much. He was always the one who would pray at the family meals growing up, and it would usually start, if you can read in the obituary, "Heavenly Father." That was always the way he always started praying, and he was extremely consistent attending church. Didn't matter where, whether it was a family or at this church in Windsor, whether it's here, he would always want to go back to church, and even during the pandemic, he was just complaining so much about why he can't just go to church. But it wasn't until I got to go inside his house, and you may have seen it on the slides in that little video clip, that was what his house looked like when we were kind of packing it down a little bit. And he, and we kind of snuck our way in, Lauren and I, because we watched him march in a Remembrance Day parade in Windsor, and we said, "Well, Grandpa, you just live 50 minutes down the road. How about we just go to your place for lunch?" And he says, no. I'm like, "Come on." He's like, "All right, sure." So he relented and let us go. And I hadn't been there in years. And we walk in, and it's amazing. It's an unreal place. Yes, there's a lot of stuff, and he was embarrassed by how much stuff he had, but it wasn't disorganized. It was perfectly organized. He had like big metal industrial chains hanging from the roof. He had a treadmill that was pulleyed up to the roof, and he would pulley it down when he would use it and pulley it back up, where it only weighed like maybe a few pounds because the system was so intricate. And he had everything was stored up in the ceiling and the roof that you could see. And I noticed in his bedroom, above his hunting rifles, a bunch of binders. And I noticed Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And I'm like, "Grampy, why do you have the Bible printed out? 66 binders." He said, "Well, the big print Bibles just aren't big enough for me. So I wanted to print them out as big as I possibly could." And I was like, "Okay." And I thought that was funny. But then reflecting back, I was like, "Huh, that's actually a lot of dedication." Because he had his little old printer that would go, jirt, 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 jirt. You know those older ones? Not the fast ones now. So that would have taken him weeks, if not months, to actually print out. And it was in that moment that I realized, oh, he was very dedicated. He wanted to cultivate his relationship with Jesus, even to the point of being able to easily read the Bible, and he put as much time into actually being able to print it as he could. But all these moments I had with Grampy throughout my life are really typified by this reoccurring memory that I have. And it's not like just one memory. It's like probably a bunch molded into one. It's a memory that brings me lots of peace, contentment, and joy. My sister and I, we spent a handful of weeks at Grampy's house in the woods as children. We'd play in the snow, canoe on the lake, run around outside with a dog, RJ. But every evening I would find myself on the floor next to the wood stove, petting this whiny dog, watching a grainy television program while Grampy fiddled with some knots or tools. And I still remember the smell. You know, that distinct grandparent and wet dog smell? That's the smell I remember. And, you know, it was nice, you know, putting the hats out because I got a little sneaky smell in the hats, and I was like, yeah, that's Grampy. Oftentimes, I wish I could go back to those moments, but because I never got to say goodbye to them, because I didn't know when they were going to end. And that moment ended without warning as I unknowingly moved on to the next. But I got to say hello to so many other moments with Grampy. For me, at least, it's not whether I got to say goodbye to Grampy, you know, being on the other side of the world and stuff, which I got kind of an opportunity, but how many times I was able to say hello. I got to say hello a lot. He was constant in my life, in Jen's life, and then in the life of Lauren and I when we lived closer to him. And he seemed to always be around. Grampy, myself, Lauren, and Audrey, love you so much, and we miss you, but our hope is in what Jesus said to Martha in John 11, where Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And then Jesus said this to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die." Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you for everyone that knew my dad and our family for coming today. For all the prayers, I mean, for me working here at the church, it gives me the honor and the privilege to have such great people around me to support our family through this whole ordeal, which is an amazing journey that Dad had. I'm not going to get into too much. Joey really hit it with the nail. Like he was a great man. A lot of people called him MacGyver because he could pretty near fix anything with a piece of gum and a rubber band. Me and my sister and my brother had the opportunity the last probably 3 weeks to spend time with him, knowing that he was really sick and he was really in a lot of pain. And the last couple weeks going off, I get a couple calls, this is probably it, and then me and Pastor Chris, we race in, and sure enough, Dad be wide awake and holding in there. So the last going off about a week ago, I went in every day with my sister. We take shifts, and Dad probably only be awake for 15 minutes at a time for 8-hour periods. So I said to my son, just before he passed, I said, "Justin, we got to get in. I'm preparing you. Dad's not looking well. You know, he looks like he's pretty near ready to go." So me and my son go in, and I look over in the cafeteria at the hospital, and I said, "Geez, that looks like Dad in the wheelchair." "Nah, can't be him. No way." So just as me and my son get to his room, all I hear is, "Richard, how many pieces of bacon do you want?" "Five." And I looked in the room, and I said, "There's no way." Sure enough, here was Dad sitting at the table, wide, fully alert. So I had the opportunity to spend that morning with him. Went out to the garden at the hospital. My sister spent the afternoon a little bit in the morning, and then Dad passed that following evening in my sister's hands. I mean, you couldn't ask for anything better than that. I mean, God blessed us with that opportunity, and that's a memory I'll always remember. Justin, I got to see him, you know, it was nice like that. And again, I just want to thank all you guys for coming and for all the prayers. I know there was other people that would like to have been here, but, you know, it's work weeks make things more difficult. And again, thank you for everything.
Short. Maybe I'll just do this. We're gonna sing a song. We're gonna see how that goes. We're gonna see if we can sing a song. I was a little ill prepared for the fact that I was gonna be this upset. We chose a song that everyone knows for the very fact that hopefully everyone will sing with me when I fail at doing this. Okay. I was promised words and a scream. Okay, that's good.
Sings my song.
have to come from words.
Did it great. Thank you so much, Jennifer and Joey. Great, great job. You're one of those pastors that can like preach and play guitar and sing and all that stuff. No one knows my struggle. Barely do the one thing that I'm doing right now. But we'll see how it goes. Well, it's hard losing a loved one, certainly, but losing a parent and a grandparent is tough. And the Bible has a lot to say about parents and children. In fact, from Scripture and from my own experience, I know this: our God is a good father. In Psalms, we see that God, as a good father, wanted to see his people, his family, preserved. The families of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he said this, or it says this in Psalms chapter 78, verses 5 to 7. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so that the next generation may know them, even the children not yet born. And they in turn will teach their own children, so that each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. little less than a week before Mr. Ferran passed away, Steve and I went to see him. On this particular occasion, we knew he wasn't doing well, but he was sitting up, and he was watching television. In fact, somehow he was watching two televisions at the same time. His leg was badly swollen. He was obviously uncomfortable, but he didn't admit that he was in any pain. The three of us sat and chatted for a while. We looked at some of his pictures, some of the pictures that actually you'll see on display at the reception following here. We talked about his time in the Navy a little bit and the ships that he had served on. And at some point, Steve left to grab his dad some juice, a little bit of a snack. And I had the opportunity to sit with Mr. Ferran, and we chatted some more. Sometimes families are amazed how much their loved ones, though as quiet as they may be, open up to pastors. It's kind of a powerful card sometimes we get to play, and I play it as often as I possibly can. So we sat and we chatted. Now, granted, most of it was me asking him questions and him giving me sometimes short responses, no question. And I know that's no surprise for those who knew him. I've had similar conversations in the past where we spoke of family and of kids and of different situations in life. I've had many conversations similar to this on a number of occasions. And I've watched people's eyes fill with happiness and pride and satisfaction when speaking of their life and of their family. Certainly this was my experience with Richard. But often those moments are mixed with looks of wonder and perhaps even a little regret, as stories inevitably bring up these memory flashes of gains and losses, of things that were said and not said, perhaps things that were done and not done, even moments of you doing your best, and I'm sure occasions where we all recognize we fall short. Very natural feelings at times like this. As I sat and spoke with Mr. Ferran, that was certainly an experience that we were having together in that moment. And I could tell from our conversation that he knew his time was getting close. And then we spoke of the things of God. And I could see the look in his eye change once more. In talking about our faith and talking about salvation and talking about the conditions of our hearts and our souls, to these things, Mr. Ferran simply said, he was at peace. Having given his heart to the Lord many years ago, Mr. Ferran had his own experience with God. Now, I am sure he did not lead a perfect life, because none of us do. That's not promised to any of us. But it was obvious to me in that moment that God was with him. In the midst of all his experiences in his life, this too was his experience, God with him. Certainly, that was the case for him in those last few days and hours. God was there. We are not promised a perfect life, but God being with us is a promise of God to all who would believe. In Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6, it says it like this, an encouragement that we should take to this very day, though it was written some thousands of years ago. It says this, so be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic, for the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will never fail you nor abandon you. Jesus said it like this while he was on the earth speaking to his disciples, saying, all of you who love me will do what I say. My Father will love them, and we will come and make our home with each of them. Anyone who doesn't love me will not obey me. And remember, my words are not my own. I am telling you what I have heard from the Father who sent me. I'm telling you these things while I'm still here with you on the earth. But when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I have told you. I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift that the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. Remember what I told you. I'm going away, but I will come back to you again. If you really love me, you will be happy that I am going to the Father who is greater than I am. I have told you these things before they happen, so that when they do happen, you will believe. This wonderful promise of Jesus Christ, that those who would believe, those who would obey him, would receive God the Father and God the Son in their own hearts, that God himself would come and make his home with us through the person of the Holy Spirit. And that person of the Holy Spirit is the person that I also encountered with when speaking with Mr. Ferran that day. It was obvious to me that the Holy Spirit had impacted him, had affected him in a way that he was able to say in that situation and circumstance at life that he was at peace. I didn't know a lot about his life. I learned so much here today. I would have loved to have seen his place and the pulleys and the levers and the chains and all the rest of it. Sounds like a very creative man. He certainly was a MacGyver. And there are many things that I know this family will treasure moving forward in stories, things he showed you how to do, perhaps moments you shared together that will inform how you spend time together as a family, and I think that's wonderful, and that's a wonderful legacy to be left for us, for those that knew Richard. But there's also a legacy that I believe he leaves for each and every one of us that is not just for this life. It's not just pulleys and levers and a cool way of doing things. It's not just memories etched in our hearts and our minds of times shared together. It is an eternal legacy, a legacy that goes past this life and the life that is to come. Just as our Heavenly Father is a good Father, and he wanted to preserve his family here upon the earth, the people of Israel, so too does he want us to preserve our families in a way that sees them not just thrive in this life, but in the life that is to come. So that generation after generation after generation, even the generation that is not yet born, will learn and come to know this wonderful legacy. That being God with us. Experiencing God making his home in our heart, the person of the Holy Spirit. That peace of heart and mind that can only come, just as Mr. Ferran experienced it, through the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says this of those who believe, from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. While we live in these earthly bodies, we groan and sigh. But it's not that we want to die and get rid of these bodies that clothe us. Rather, we want to put on our new bodies so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by life. God himself has prepared us for this, and as a guarantee, he has given us his Holy Spirit. So we are always confident, even knowing that as long as we live in these earthly bodies, we are not at home with the Lord, for we live by believing and not by seeing. Yes, we are fully confident that we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to please him, for we all must stand before Christ to be judged. We will receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done in this earthly body. Richard Ferran was swallowed up not by death and the grave, but Richard was swallowed up by life, eternal life. A life he now experiences in the fullness of God, the full presence of God. Because now his experience with God is not just this thing that has transpired in his heart. He is in the place where God is, in full glory, in fullness of presence, experiencing all the love and relationship that God offers those who believe. This is the legacy that every father should wish to leave to their children, the legacy of faith. This is what we all should teach our children so that they can teach their children the same, so that each generation can set its hope anew on the Lord, not forgetting his glorious sacrifice upon the cross, sharing with us the miracle of eternal life. I will miss seeing Richard here, coming in and for the most part the last off in his wheelchair, but faithful. And I pray in some way his presence here will be contagious to the point where people start coming to church an hour and a half early, because right now it feels like they come an hour and a half late. So that would be really good too. But I will miss him. He will be missed, but we won't miss him forever. For those who believe, we'll see Richard again one day. For those who believe, we have the opportunity to be in that heavenly place together again. As I said, experiencing the fullness of God. If you're here today and you are not a believer, you don't know what I mean when I say a believer, this is what it means. It means just as in the songs we have sung here today, believing that Jesus was delivered by God unto death upon a cross as punishment for our sin. That even though Christ was buried, that God raised him from the dead 3 days later. Believing that as we agree with those facts as stated in God's word, that forgiveness and righteousness is received from God to us as we believe these things. The Bible says, if you believe these facts and confess them with your mouth, you will be saved. Saved from your sin. Saved from a life eternal, separate from God. It says this in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 to 11. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. As the scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. I'd like to give us all an opportunity to come to this saving faith that Richard knew and still knows so very well. And with that in mind, just in reverence of this moment, I just encourage everyone in this room just to close your eyes with me for just a moment. You know, it's sometimes sad to me that it takes us to get to the very end of life to kind of contemplate the more important things. It's something that we should really think about all the time. How am I living my life? What am I doing with my life? What am I doing concerning Jesus Christ? And as you consider that in your own heart, in your own life today, if you could not say today with assurance that God is with you, if you can not say today that Christ has made his home in your heart, if you cannot lay claim today to the promise of Scripture, the promise of peace of mind and heart that comes to those who believe, I want to give you that opportunity today. Just with our eyes closed in this moment, whether you're here or perhaps you're even watching online, I just encourage you to make some sort of sign towards God today that you want to commit your life to him, that you want to follow in Richard's footsteps, live in that legacy of a person who has given their heart to God. If that describes you in any way today, just with your eyes closed, I just encourage us in this room. If that's you, just raise your hand. Do something to indicate to me that I'm praying with you today. Do not want anyone to leave here without having this opportunity to confess Jesus as Lord. I'm only going to wait just a moment, just a moment. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, for those of us that have gathered here and those of us that are watching online, I'm just going to lead us in a short prayer, allowing those that are desiring to respond today to pray to God. Me leading you in this prayer is just my way of attempting to perhaps give you the words of what is transpiring in your heart. And I encourage all the believers who are here with us to join with me in this prayer by repeating this after me and saying, Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sin and invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust you and follow you as my Lord and Savior. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today for the first time or perhaps for the first time in a long time, I encourage you to reach out to us here at the church. Connect with us in some way. Really, what you've done here today is to take a first step towards a journey of following Christ, and we would love to connect with you and help you in any way we can. And as I welcome, we're going to play this song, sorry, when we all get to heaven. And as we do, just before we do, as I lead us in this closing prayer, as this song is played, I'm just going to encourage us to stand to our feet as we allow the family to leave. And I would encourage all of us to come and to join us for a short reception time that will take place in our Family Life Center. We'll have some people that will direct you, but it's just an opportunity for you to personally connect with the family, share a little bit of food and a coffee or tea or something to drink, just as we kind of take this moment together. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this day. We thank you again for the life of Richard Joseph Ferrand. We thank you for allowing us the blessing of sharing a portion of our life with him and the lives of the family that has come into being through his lineage. Father God, we pray in the same way that you have touched and been with Richard, that you would touch and be with us. Help us to continue in this legacy of faith. Help us to remain faithful through the end of time here, knowing that this end is not the end, that we will be with you one day forever in eternity. And until that time, Lord God, we pray for the Ferrand family that they would experience a special blessing of your grace, a special outpouring of your love and your comfort, especially at a time like this. We speak a blessing upon them and all those who are in attendance. We declare these things in Jesus' name. Let's stand to our feet together. Lord. Just as that continues to play, thank you so much. You are dismissed. And again, we will see you at our reception hall that's located just up the stairs and towards what we call the Family Life Center. The Lord bless you. Thank you so much for coming. Yeah.